Good evening. Welcome to the Monrovia City Council for this evening, Tuesday, June 19th, 2012. We will begin this evening with an invocation by Pastor Dorothy Scott and our Pledge of Allegiance by our Mayor Pro Tem Joe Garcia.
Spireheads, we are so grateful for all of the many, many blessings upon this city, for every business, for every positive thing. Thank you for covering us. Thank you for your wisdom. Thank you for the great people, and thank you for the leadership of this council. We thank you for tonight's agenda. Thank you for the wisdom moving throughout the proceedings, and we ask this in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Would you all please join me in the pledge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Stillman, we have a report of the closed session. I'm sorry, roll call.
Council members Adams.
Here.
Shevlin.
Here.
Spicer.
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Garcia.
Here.
Mayor Lutz.
Present. And now, if we have a report of the closed session, please.
Thank you, Mayor. Prior to the meeting this evening at 6:30, the council met in closed session regarding the two items on the posted agenda and took no reportable action on either item.
Thank you. We have one presentation this evening, but the person that we're presenting it to is not with us as of yet. So what I'm going to do with the council's indulgence is, should he arrive, we will put that into the next scheduled opening we have this evening. If not, we'll postpone it for another council meeting. So we're going to move ahead right now on to, our student government representative will be back in September with a whole new year and a whole new representative. And we'll start with the order of the business. Ms. Lyle, do we have any change to our order of business?
Yes, we do this evening, Mayor. You have a consent calendar item 6. It's a temporary lease of some water rights from the City of Alhambra. We would suggest you pull that from the consent calendar and conduct a discussion of that item at the end of the agenda. And that's the only change I would suggest this evening.
Okay, thank you. We will do that.
I thought I saw a change on item 8 as well.
Just for information.
That's a typo change?
Item 8 is a revision to the cost for the advertising. They've agreed to lower their price 5
okay.
cents. So that's just a correction to that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Next is our consent calendar.
Move approval.
I'll second that.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. This motion carries. And we will now move to our public comment period. This is the time for anybody who would like to speak to this city council on any item which is not currently on the agenda may do so. All you need to do is fill out a blue speaker card and our city clerk will call your name.
Annie Lamb.
Hi, my name is Annie Lamb. I'm the Monrovia High School Band Council President. This is Travis Stone. He's the drum major of the MHS Band, and this is Isaac Silva. He's the Vice President of the MHS Band. We wanted to give you guys goodie bags and thank you for your support of the band in the past school year and your continuing support in the coming school year. And I can see we're short a few goodie bags, so we'll bring more next time. I just wanted to let the community know that the band, like many other programs in the schools, has really been hit hard by the economy. We haven't been able to afford section coaches. We haven't been able to afford new uniforms and new instruments. It's really affected the band. You know, even though we did manage to go to Carnegie Hall this past school year and we did amazingly well there, we can do so much more. And we really need the community's support. So Travis is going to talk about upcoming fundraisers.
Okay, so first off, we're gonna have a series of three different car washes at Walgreens near Ralph's over the summer. First one's coming on June 23rd. Following ones are on July 23rd and August 18th. Any community support in coming out and just giving the $5, we'll have bake sales, items, things to buy, lots of cool little things, and it's a really great way to support us and the rest of the community that that we like to support and entertain. Secondly, we just finished our incoming freshman basics camp this past week, where we took all of our freshmen in and we sort of taught them the basics of what we do and how we do it. In the past years, we've gotten somewhere around 11, 15 new members, and which is basically the amount of seniors leaving. This year, we got 30, which is a lot more than we're used to, and as of now, a little more than we can support as far as uniforms and instruments go. So any support and donations, donations coming out, fundraisers, would really be appreciated. Anyone who knows any form of getting donations or would like to contribute can contact Mr. M at the high school, our director. And here's Isaac for a few more fundraisers.
March of 2013, we will have two very large events. We were going to have a drumline competition. We had one this past year. It was very successful, so the Drumline Association asked us to host a two-day show. We will also have a color guard show on the 3rd of March. We're going to need lots of resources to make these happen, like such as, you know, opportunity drawings, lighting for parking lots, safety cones, water, soft drinks, items for concession. Yeah, they're very big events, and we need as much help as possible. Thank you.
We have some flyers for our car wash on Saturday. I was hoping we could leave those here.
Okay. Absolutely.
All right, thank you. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Congratulations. I'm very impressed that you're spending your summer doing fundraising and thinking about next year. Congratulations and good luck.
Ahmad Solomon.
Good evening, Mayor, Council. I really just came by tonight to introduce myself. It's been about a month since I've been on the job at Southern California Edison. I filled the vacancy that was left by Elisa Clifford. I think quite a few of you, if not everyone in this room, may know who she is. Again, just dropped in to say hello. So the first time you see me isn't necessarily if there's any emergency or anything that needs immediate attention. It's more just to introduce myself, see my face, and I see yours, and let you know that I'm looking forward to working with all of you and getting to know all of you and the community of Monrovia. I've heard really good things about the city. I'm not from here, but I had some family that lived here a few years ago. My daughter plays soccer occasionally here. She's on a club team, and they move around a lot, so I'm in the area quite a bit. And but again, just looking forward to working with all of you, and I know that some positive things have already taken place. I was fortunate enough when I first came on board, the first week on the job, to meet Mayor Lutz and talk about the PEV program that Edison has and her experience with the plug-in electric vehicles and the wonderful things that the city of Monrovia is doing to be green and whatnot. So again, just looking forward to working with all of you and being a part of the community. So thank you for the time.
Thank you and welcome.
Thank you.
Brenda Trainer, and is it Ernie Dogs?
Sit down. Good evening, Mayor and Council. This is Ernie. We call him Ernie Dogs. His father's name is Dodds, but we use Dogs for him because we don't want to offend his father, of course. But we're here from Wonder Dog Ranch. We're Monrovia's newest dog daycare and boarding facility, and this week we are celebrating Take Your Dog to Work Week. Friday is the national celebration of Take Your Dog to Work Day, and as part of this celebration, we're encouraging everybody in Monrovia, and pretty much everybody in Monrovia, we think, has a dog,
And we encourage them to visit all of the dog-related and pet-related businesses. And we certainly want to also encourage the businesses in Monrovia to have dog-at-work policies. And if that's not possible, to encourage dog ownership and responsible dog ownership, because it's such a good benefit and it's part of a very effective health benefits and wellness program in a lot of employee-employer relationship programs. And we certainly want to encourage that. We are offering free consultations to any employers who want to create either a dog at work policy or an effective employee wellness program for responsible dog ownership. And the more important thing is, and I have invitations with me, but I think you've all gotten them, we're doing our grant opening celebration tomorrow afternoon from 4:30 to 7:30 at Wonder Dog Ranch at 220 Taylor Street. That's just two blocks south of Duarte Road on the east side of the road. And we certainly want to encourage you all to come and celebrate at our Yappy Hour and our ribbon cutting in cooperation with the Monrovia Chamber of Commerce. And I thank you very much for your time tonight.
Thank you.
I'm Pam Fitzpatrick. I'm an Old Town merchant. And Brenda at Wonder Dog Ranch helped me find a couple of months ago a little puppy that I named Tutti Frutti. And I have a take your dog to work policy in my store, and that is every day, all day, at the store or in my office. And it started out because I didn't want to leave her at home because she's a puppy and I'm afraid she would be lonesome or chew the furniture. And it got to be that if I leave her at home, I'm lonesome. So I just want to attest to the fact that taking your dog to work is a wonderfully healthy thing to do. And I also want to tell you that from 21 years ago when we first came here to now in Old Town, we have seen a real change in stores in Old Town as far as dog friendliness. There's dogs everywhere. We encourage it. We've got water bowls out everywhere. And where it used to be like, oh my goodness, you're bringing a dog in the store, it's like, oh, come on, bring your dog in the store. So it's a wonderful idea, and I thoroughly support it. Thank you.
Thank you. There are no other speaker cards at this time. Is there anybody else who would like to speak to this council about any item that is not currently on the agenda? You may come forward.
Good evening, Mayor and City Council members. My name is Delphine Spicer, and I reside at 117 East Otara Street in the city of Monrovia. Normally, I watch the City Council meetings from the comfort of my home, but what I viewed on the last two City Council meetings touched my inner core so much to the point that I had to come here tonight and set the record straight. My neighbor to the west, Mike Vallejo, began with allegations on how Councilman Larry Spicer was bullying the neighborhood and how he needed to get a restraining order and how his father had lived there for 40 years, as well as many other neighbors had lived there for years, and they just want to live in peace and not feel threatened. He went on and on with his rants while providing letters to the mayor and city council members to supposedly substantiate his claims. One should be aware that before one attempts to tell a story, one should ensure that they tell the entire story and not leave out bits and pieces in order to craft it in such a way that paints a flawless picture on their end. Since he failed to do so, I, Delphine Spicer, will do it for him, or will assist him in this effort. The story goes like this. There's a wall on the west side of our property that we share with Mike Vallejo, a 30-plus-year-old male who lives at home with his parents. On his side of the property are trees that his father planted. The tree branches were beginning to grow on our side of the property, but the father did not want Councilman Spicer to cut them, even if they were protruding on our side of the small brick wall. In November of 2011, 7 months ago, Mike Vallejo approached Councilman Spicer and told him that his father would be away in Mexico for 3 weeks and that he, Mike, would cut the trees at that time. Mike Vallejo came into our yard and cut the tree branches that had been protruding on our side. A few days later, Mike came to Councilman Spicer and stated that he, Councilman Spicer, had cut the trees too much and became very upset. Councilman Spicer told Mike that he was the one who came into our yard and himself cut the trees. Please be aware that Mike Vallejo had told Councilman Spicer on a previous occasion that his father stated if he had cut these trees on either side of the brick wall, that he, the father, would put Mike out of the house. So Mike Vallejo had to falsely accuse someone. Mike stated he told his sister what had happened, apparently that Councilman Spicer had cut the trees, and she stated to call the police. He did. The police came out and spoke with Councilman Spicer, and the police stated that they had just spoken with the father regarding this matter. Councilman Spicer informed the police officer that the father was away in Mexico, so in fact he was talking to the son, Mike Vallejo. Later, code enforcement came out, and many demands were placed on Mike's father. The father had to cut the trees that were growing against the garage, cut some of the trees in their front yard that had created a jungle-like environment, and fix or move an old car that had been sitting stagnated in their driveway for quite some time. Mike was upset because now he realized he had created more problems for his father. Councilman Spicer wanted to know why Mike would not just tell his father the truth, that he was the one who cut the trees. By being untruthful, Mike had created much a bigger problem than he had bargained for. Now, prior to this incident in November 2011, 7 months ago, Mike had been on friendly terms with Councilman Spicer. Mike would bring us tangerines from his tree, knock at our door to let us know that his parrot had escaped to our backyard and he was coming to get him. Christmas of 2010, he baked us a cake. And let's not forget the 3-foot bronze fish sculpture he made for us last year that at this very moment sits near our garage. So where did all this anger come from? Mike was more afraid of his father and the repercussions that he faced due to the recent demands put on them by code enforcement. So Mike had to find a way to get at Councilman Spicer. Now let it be known that in the 20 years that myself and Councilman Spicer had lived at our address, I have never seen Mike talk to any of the other neighbors. He basically kept to himself. In fact, I can't really recall him living there the entire time that I lived there. However, at some point, he did resurface and come home to live with his parents. And as stated earlier, Mike was upset and wanted to retaliate against Councilman Spicer. At some point, he began to canvass our small cul-de-sac of 9 homes, searching for neighbors who had a complaint against Councilman Spicer. He found 2 willing participants and 1 neighbor who had moved away 8 years ago. Together, they joined forces, and the lynch mob began to take action. Now, as heard in the previous meetings, there were the neighbors who stated Councilman Spicer harassed their granddaughters for revving up his engine when they passed by and called them names, or one neighbor he met down the street with a stick in his hand, while the wife of that same neighbor stated he harassed her daycare parents and hurt her business financially and followed some of the same parents all the way to Pasadena. Or the letter from the neighbor who moved away 8 years ago, who stated that Councilman Spicer sent her flowers at work and she was alarmed because he found out where she worked. Or when Councilman Spicer wet his wife with a high pressure water hose. These stories are twisted and exaggerated and in no way current as Mike Vallejo has presented them. Was Mike Vallejo present, or did he witness any of these alleged allegations? The disagreement with these 2 neighbors happened approximately 2002, 10 years ago. Let me put that into perspective for you. My oldest child was in the 5th grade. She's now a junior in college. My middle child was in preschool. He's now in the 9th grade. And my youngest baby was a baby, and she's now in the 6th grade. The thing that puzzles me is that if these allegations were so violent and cruel in nature, Why didn't these two neighbors ever call the police? Why didn't these two neighbors ever write a letter to city council? Why didn't these two neighbors ever attend the city council meetings and speak? Why didn't these two neighbors ever ask to speak to the chief of police? Why didn't any of these daycare parents ever call the police when having Councilman Spicer allegedly follow them all the way to Pasadena? For the neighbor who moved away 8 years ago, who stated that Councilman Spicer sent her flowers at work and alarmed her because he found out where she worked, did she forget that she used to come over to my house and use my computer to do her homework, preparing for the same job that she had, and her place of employment was common knowledge? For the neighbor with the daycare who stated that Councilman Spicer tried to destroy her daycare business financially, were you aware that just last year a neighbor needed a daycare for his two toddlers and Councilman Spicer recommended you and you still have those two children in your daycare today? The bigger question is, why after 10 years do these neighbors now want to write a letter to the city council and talk to the chief of police and even attend the last city council meetings and cheer and applaud when Mike Vallejo, their spokesperson, read their letters from alleged incidents 10 years ago? So why after 10 years did the two neighbors and the one neighbor who moved away come forward? You know why? Because Larry Spicer is now Councilman Spicer. When approached by Mike Vallejo, they were eager to take part in this lynch mob, even if their alleged stories were 10 years ago. What a better way than try to embarrass an active city council member than on live television? The pot of jealousy and hate had been brewing for 10 years, and like a cobra, they saw the prime opportunity to strike, and they did. And Mike Vallejo, in your anger and determination to destroy Councilman Spicer, you canvassed the neighborhood or the cul-de-sac looking for willing participants, and you found two families. In all your ranting, you included my name, Delphine Spicer, and mentioned my name twice on public airways, stating that I had been wet with a high-pressure water hose. Isn't a high-pressure water hose the ones that firemen use to put out fires? Your qualm was never with me. So why did you twice slander my name over public airways? Were you there to witness this alleged incident? You had hearsay and you ran with it. Now you have another problem, and that's my contemplation over taking legal action. And for all the participants in this lynch mob who have children and grandchildren, I am utterly ashamed of you. After 10 years, you all decided to come forward in a public forum in an effort to humiliate and embarrass Councilman Spicer. In any of your discussions, and I'm sure you had many, did you ever consider the harm you might cause to his three children? I'm sure you know that children are very fragile and they're not as strong as us adults. What harm would it do to them to hear their father being publicly lynched over alleged incidents that occurred 10 years ago? But I'm sure you probably never even thought of this. Your only goal was to get back at Councilman Spicer. You loaded Mike Vallejo with your arsenal of letters and chose Mike Vallejo as your spokesperson. You all decided that after 10 years, these alleged matters now needed to be addressed. Really, after 10 years? Did you think that the stories would be better with time, just like a bottle of fine wine? But you know what? By God's grace and mercy, the bite of the venomous cobra had no effect on Councilman Spicer, nor myself. We are still standing. Councilman Spicer is a strong man who has served his country for 21 years in the United States Army. Something as evil and as vindictive as this will not break him. I, Delphine Spicer, am equally as strong. You cannot break us. You cannot bend us. Like the palm tree that blows in the wind, at the end of the storm, it is still standing and strong. And there's an old Cherokee proverb that says how the cow runs away from the storm, but while the buffalo charges directly towards it and gets through it quicker, well, Larry and I are the buffalo. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to speak to this council about any item that is not on our current agenda? Seeing and hearing none, I will close the public comment period. And we will now take up public hearings. Our first hearing is the fiscal year 2012-13 Citywide Lighting and Landscaping Maintenance Assessment District. Lauren Vasquez will give us our staff report.
Good evening, Mayor and members of the City Council. The Citywide Lighting and Landscaping Maintenance District provides the funding for the maintenance and upkeep of the public street lighting and traffic signals, street trees, the street median and parkway areas, including Myrtle Avenue, Huntington Drive, Cypress Avenue, and Maple Avenue, and the parkway areas for the Gold Hills development. An annual budgetary review of the proposed assessment is required as part of the procedures the city must follow under the Landscaping and Lighting Act of 1972. On March 6, Council initiated proceedings for the levy and collection of assessments and authorized the preparation of the engineer's report. On May 15, Council approved the engineer's report, declared the intention to levy an assessment for fiscal year 2012-2013, and set this public hearing. An equivalent dwelling unit method is used to determine the apportionment of assessment. The total estimated costs are divided into four classifications. The lighting and traffic signals are the Zone A. The Zone B is the street trees. The Zone C covers the medians and parkway landscaping. And the Zone D covers the Golden Hill Parkway landscaping. Based on this analysis, the proposed assessment for a single family dwelling unit for fiscal year 2012-2013 is $56.23. This proposed assessment is consistent with the rate charged over the last 10 years. Staff recommends confirming and levying the fiscal year 2012-2013 Citywide Lighting and Landscaping Maintenance District Assessment. If the City Council concurs, the appropriate action is included in the staff report. This concludes my report on this item. I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Are there any questions of staff? Lauren, I just would like if you could clarify the costs of our assessment have gone up over this past year, the cost to the city, correct?
There is a $4,000 increase.
Right. And I think what I want to clarify is while we have incurred additional costs, it is not our intent to increase the amount of each household to pay for this, that we'll be absorbing that within our budget.
Correct.
Yeah, I just think that it's important that we clarify that for our citizens to realize that the cost has gone up, but we are not going to be asking for assessment money, any more assessment money from our residents.
Correct.
Thank you. Are there any additional questions?
I do have a question, because if I read this correctly, it is going up 2.1%.
That is the...
The CPI increase?
That is for the park assessment district.
For the what?
I'm sorry.
No, that you're looking at PH2. This is, we're doing PH1.
Whoop. Thank you.
Sorry.
Okay, unless there are any other questions, we'll entertain a motion. I'm sorry, this is a public hearing, you're right. Is there anybody in the public who would like to speak to this item? You may please come forward.
Good evening, Mayor Lutz and all the City Council, the City Clerk, the City Attorney. I'm Gwendolyn Jones and I live at 521 East Los Angeles. And I'm your neighbor here in Monrovia. My question is, I'm not understanding the cost. You said that there's a $4,000 increase to the city?
Yes.
On all the parcels?
Over last, let me see if I can explain it. The total cost of all of these lighting and landscaping costs increases by $4,000 from what we paid last year to do the same thing. But what we're not doing is increasing each resident's part of their payment to us for it. It'll be absorbed by our general budget.
Where does the $56.23 come from?
That's the amount that comes from the residents, but it's not increasing from previous years. It's staying flat.
So is this $56.23 the same amount that we're already levied on our real estate tax?
Correct.
So, okay, so the new cost, the $4,000, none of the residents in Monrovia will be expected to pay it?
Correct.
Okay, so we're going to be paying the same amount we did last real estate tax time, $211,212.
For this lighting district.
So
yes.
you're just informing us that the city took a hit of $4,000, but you're not going to hit us with any more money.
You could say it that way if you like, yes.
Thank you for this space.
Thank you.
What she needs to know is actually $48.76. Right?
I'm sorry, Larry?
Wouldn't that be the actual cost? The additional cost is $4,876?
$4,876 is the total additional cost that we will be incurring in our city budget.
Thank you for looking out for us.
You're welcome. Is there anybody else who would like to speak to this item? Okay, then I will close the public hearing and entertain a motion.
I'll move adoption.
I second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. This passes. And we'll move on to our next item, which is public hearing number two. This is the 2012-13 Park Maintenance Assessment District. And Lauren Vasquez will give us this report as well.
The Park Maintenance District provides funding to maintain seven city parks, which include Canyon, Library, Recreation, Rotary, Lucinda Garcia, Julian Fisher, and Grand Avenue Park. An annual budgetary review of the proposed assessment is required as part of the procedures the city must follow under the Landscaping and Lighting Act of 1972 and under the assessment conditions of Proposition 218. On March 6, Council initiated the proceedings for the assessment district and the preparation of the engineer's report, followed by the approval of the report on May 15th and setting this public hearing. The levy of annual assessment for 2012-2013 fiscal year is based on the Consumer Price Index, which is currently at 2.1%. Based on the analysis using the equivalent dwelling unit method, for a typical single-family dwelling unit, there is an assessment increase of 22 cents. The proposed annual assessment rate for fiscal year 2012-2013 will be $10.89. Staff recommends confirming and levying the assessment for the fiscal year 2012-2013 Park Maintenance District. If the council concurs, the appropriate action is included in the staff report. This concludes my report. I'd be happy to answer any questions you have.
Questions of staff? Okay, again, this is a public hearing. Is there anybody who would like to speak to this item? Come forward.
Gwendolyn Jones, your Monrovia neighbor. My question to this item is, the monies that you will recover at $10.89 for each piece of real estate, will you use that to improve anything over at Fisher Park or various other parks, or will this go into a miscellaneous slush fund? Will any of this money be earmarked to do upgrades at the parks that need it?
I'm going to let Ms. Lyle answer the question as to where the money will go.
Thank you.
I can just tell you right now, this city has no such thing as a slush fund. If we ever did, those days are long gone.
Thank you so much.
I'm going to let Ms. Lyle talk about what kind of things we're planning for parks.
Actually, I'm going to ask Mr. Alvarado to respond to that.
This Park Maintenance Assessment District is exactly it. The money's for this assessment maintenance is the maintenance and upkeep of the parks. At only $10 per parcel, it's $211,000. It is just a small piece of the overall parks budget. There's not enough money in this revenue to be able to be set aside for improvements at any of the parks. This money is strictly for the maintenance and the upkeeps of the seven city parks.
Okay. Any other questions or is there any other speakers on this item? Then I'll close the public hearing and ask if there are any other questions. If not, we'll entertain a motion.
Move adoption.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. This motion carries. And we will now convene the Monrovia Housing Authority meeting this evening without adjourning the Monrovia City Council meeting. And we will ask for roll call, please.
Board members Adams.
Here.
Shevlin.
Here.
Spicer.
Here.
Vice Chairman Garcia.
Here.
Chairman Lutz.
Present.
Move consent.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. And our next item is the adoption of the fiscal year budget for the, where am I here? For the Housing Authority, I'm sorry. And Lauren Vasquez will again give us our report. Sorry, Lauren.
In 2004, the city created the Monrovia Housing Authority to work cooperatively with the former Monrovia Redevelopment Agency to establish activities, services, and facilities that would contribute to the rehabilitation and development of affordable and quality housing throughout the city. Since its creation, the Housing Authority has been inactive, with the key provisions of ABX 126, also known as the Dissolution Act. A city that formed a redevelopment agency became the successor agency unless it opted not to. The city of Monrovia assumed that responsibility and became the successor agency to the former Monrovia Redevelopment Agency. The city also had the option to retain the affordable housing assets and functions previously performed by the agency, but declined and selected the Monrovia Housing Authority to assume those responsibilities. An annual budgetary review is needed to be in compliance with state law. The Housing Authority's budget for the upcoming fiscal year is $291,248. This includes 1.25 full-time equivalent positions to manage the program and $147,500 in potential home improvement grants. Over the next year, the activities of the Housing Authority will be centered around the Monrovia Area Partnership Program. And for those members of the community that are unfamiliar with the MAP program, it was a program developed by the Neighborhood Strategy Team, a team comprised of staff members of all city departments who meet on a regular basis to address community neighborhood issues. In 2006, to address concerns such as increased crime and citizen apathy in the MAP neighborhoods. The primary function of the program has been to decrease crime and blight while encouraging residents to engage in the community in a productive manner. A key component of the program this year will be resident development, and it will be encouraged through community events and outreach, such as the 5th Annual MAP Adult Leadership and Development Academy, the 3rd Annual Citywide MAP Neighborhood Conference, the 2nd Annual MAP Youth Leadership Development Academy, through quarterly neighborhood leader continuing educational meetings, and through continued support and outreach through monthly newsletters, neighborhood alerts on safety information, neighborhood websites and blogs, MAP incident team block visitations, and volunteer opportunities. In addition, the neighborhood strategy team will continue to assess and address the neighborhood's needs. The funds for this program are allocated from the housing bond proceeds, and staff recommends adoption of the budget as presented. If the board concurs, the appropriate action is included in the staff report. This concludes my reports. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Are there any questions of staff?
I think this is kind of related, and I don't know that anybody has the answer yet, but I think we used to get about $1 million a year in the low to moderate income housing set aside. Is any of that in here yet, or has that not been determined up in Sacramento?
I believe the set-aside is still in flux. Under some of the cleanup legislation that is still proposed in Sacramento, right now there is no housing set-aside.
Okay.
There are a lot of housing advocates, though, that would like to see that set-aside reestablished. But right now, the funding for this is out of the bonds.
Okay.
That were previously sold.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yes, so the $147,500, those funds are actually there for the home improvement grants?
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, we will entertain a motion.
Make a motion to adopt resolution number H 2012-01.
I'll second.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Motion carries. Thank you, Lauren. At this time, we will reconvene the Monrovia City Council meeting, and we will commence City Council reports. And I will start with Mayor Pro Tem Garcia.
Thank you, Mayor. Yesterday, Mayor Lutz and I, along with staff, as part of the city's outreach to various corporate businesses in our city, met with the Chief Operating Officer of Mount Sierra College, and along with some of their other staff, I think the admissions director and a couple of other people, primarily to outreach with the college in terms of their mentorship, how hopefully that we as a city can partner together to possibly give more awareness in terms of what the college offers, not only to residents in the community, but to, you know, prospective students and admissions. Excellent meeting. I will tell you, I was very impressed with the campus and the technology that was basically presented to us. This is a college that offers graduate degrees in various forms of graphic design and business visual arts, and also with regards to game design as well. And the list of job placement partnerships that they have created with other corporate CEOs is like a who's who of the business world, and it was extremely impressive. I'm looking forward to hopefully watching you know, our staff collaborate with them and you know, possibly create more programs that we can work together with them. I know they're going to be hosting the upcoming CEO breakfast. Is it breakfast or
reception?
And you know, I believe that the other businesses in the community who may have not had the experience of knowing that we have such a great institute of learning there are going to be duly impressed. And I'm not sure, Mayor, if you want to add anything to that, but like I said, I walked away from there very impressed with this college here.
I think you said it very well. I have nothing else to add. It is very impressive. Very impressive.
And that's all I have.
Okay, thank you. Councilmember Adams.
No report this evening. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Shevlin.
Yes, thank you. I wanted to remind everyone that the community services, their department, or their summer schedule is now out, and you should have all received it at home. It's also online on the city's website. And I wanted to highlight again, get a bang for your buck, help support Monrovia's 4th of July fireworks show. You can still go online and make a contribution to that fantastic event. And I know for those of you that have been there before, it really is something special. And for those of you that have not come out and join us, but you can donate online on the website. Also, on the schedule of classes, it has on the front of the brochure, it has all the summer concert series on there, which start, well, we have the one on 4th of July, but then the following Sunday is the first Sunday concert, and those go from July 8th to August 26th. So come out at the band shell and Library Park and have a great time. Also, our library has wonderful summer programs. The reading program that started on June 11th, and then free Monday night movies. They have Wednesday grade adventures for second to fifth graders, and come in and check that out at the library. And there's summer dinner theaters, and our the MAFA Association of Fine Arts also starts their summer art walks in our old town on Saturday, June 30th, and then in July and August on the last Saturday of the month, and that's from 6:30 to 10 p.m. in our old town. Come down and visit. And for the rest of my report, I would like to have today we had a job fair held at the community center, and I'm bringing up Jennifer McLean here to give us a little update on what went on today.
Great. Thank you, Councilwoman Shevlin. Good evening, Madam Mayor, members of council. So a few months back, Councilwoman Shevlin encouraged us to follow suit of one of our neighboring cities, whose name I will not mention, and to work on developing a job fair with Best Jobs Magazine. So I'm happy to report that many phone calls later, many meetings later, we had a job fair this morning at the community center, and it attracted more than 220 job seekers and 30 exhibitors. The event was run in partnership with Best Jobs Magazine, and what they do is they come into a community and they work on assisting with finding employers and coming up with promotions for the event. And the city's responsibility is to find local employers and to also help with promoting the event and provide the location. Now with the location, we have community services staff to thank. Rebecca Romero and Carrie Zessau were extremely helpful in helping set this up and break down the event and provide the location. So as I mentioned, there are about 220 job seekers, and each of these events typically get about 150 to 300 job seekers. So we were right there in terms of attendance. They would come in, register, have a little workshop, and then go in and see the employers. We had folks like Mount Sierra College was there, Ducommun Aerostructures, and the city of Monrovia as well. We had Jeff Lambert from our library division promoting the job seekers program. And then we also had the Human Resources Department and our Economic Development team there as well. So out of this, what's great is that it wasn't just that we provide potential jobs for these folks, and the fact that it was free, that's another great asset to this, is we developed a relationship with Best Jobs Magazine. So one of their programs moving forward will be a youth job development aspect, and that's something that we at the city have been really working on and trying to brainstorm how we could bring that to fruition. So we look forward to working with Best Jobs Magazine in the future on this. So thank you very much, Councilwoman Shevlin.
Thank you,
Jen. Is there any way to tell how many real jobs came out of this? I know that would be down the road a ways, but
you know, that's a great question. Best Jobs Magazine, they made sure that they registered everybody at the event. Yeah. So that would be a wonderful follow-up for us to see what actually came out of that. So I'm sure that we can come up with some figures great. For you.
Thank you.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's it.
Okay. Council Member Spicer.
Yes, Mayor. Council Member Becky Shevlin and myself, we were able to participate in the MAP Neighborhood Leadership potluck this weekend. The potluck went really well. The fire department was there. They gave a presentation on emergency preparedness and highlighted various techniques citizens can undertake to prepare for disasters. They also invited some of the MAP leaders to join in on the citizens' emergency response training at several local venues. Neighborhood services staff offered brief community updates, including the announcement of the new city manager and Lori Law, and also the Friday night wildlife, and the new neighborhood website, nextdoor.com. Let's see, also Jessica Cabal, is that her name?
Cabal.
Volunteer coordinator of the San Gabriel Valley Volunteer Center, presented information about the upcoming Make a Difference Day. Carol Camp and Rebecca Elder of the Public Library, they were there explaining to us their developing of programs involving community and family storytelling, cultural awareness, and technology across the Generations and Commission map for neighborhood leaders to support the development of these projects and programs. Neighborhood leader Eloise Hart invited everyone to the Monrovia Duarte Black Alumni Association 20th Annual Family Day Picnic, which will be held at Rec Park from 11 to 5 p.m. this Saturday. All proceeds will go to the scholarships for youth attending college. Anyone wishing or they need any detail, more detail, please contact Beverly Haynes, 626-358-0060, or Eloise Hart at 626-529-5671. Neighborhood leader Betty Thomas suggested that there should be more participation by the MAP leaders. And also, I forgot, Mayor, there were also the new youth leaders was there. Council member Becky Shevlin announced that the Monrovia Kiwanis and Rotary Clubs will be having a cleanup day on Saturday.
Yeah, I forgot it. My announcement.
June 23rd.
This Saturday. Come out and clean up.
And all of the MAP leaders was invited. Tiffany Scott, I believe she's part of the Teen Advisory Board. And Jessica Tang, they announced the summer reading clubs at the library. MAP staff reminded everyone about the upcoming annual MAP Neighborhood Conference, which is scheduled for Saturday, August the 11th. Neighborhood leader Raina Martinez announced that the Foothill Unity Center back-to-school distribution will be held at the Santa Anita Racetrack on Thursday, August the 15th. She added that a retirement party for former executive director Joan Whiteneck will be held on Thursday the 28th at the Doubletree. And that's for more information, reservations, contact Barbara Rolf at the center, 626-358-3486. Sherman Avenue residents announced that this summer they will be hosting a fish fry and barbecue. Neighborhood leaders from different areas in Monrovia are working together to plan the details of this event. Also, the Yules shared about the success of the Fig Avenue Neighbors Group that meet on a regular basis to address neighborhood concerns and to encourage engagement in the betterment of the community. She invited everyone to their upcoming block party scheduled for July 14th. She also spoke of diverse cultural celebrations that were held recently in honor of Martin Luther King, Cesar Chavez, and race unity. Community Development Director Steve Sizemore remarked on the importance of the MAP program and how much the leaders have an effect and a positive attitude which can go into the community with change. And I would like to thank the Community Development Services for all of their work this past weekend. It was a success, and that's my end of my report. Kind of long.
Thank you very much. That was probably the longest report you've given us, Councilmember Spicer.
It's a blessing.
Before or this? It all is. Councilmember Shevlin did forget to tell us about her big program this weekend.
I wanted to remind everybody that, yes, on this Saturday, the 23rd, Saturday, from 8 a.m. to 11 a.m., we are going to be at Recreation Park and then in the Old Town area doing cleanup, picking up trash and debris, and also some light weeding. If you want to clean up Old Town, please come to the fountain at the Library Park at 8 a.m. If you want to clean up at Recreation Park, they're going to meet at the north end of the park there. That's Lemon, right?
North is Lemon.
Yeah, on Lemon, probably somewhere around the historic museum. Ideas start from one end and go to the other and clean up everything in between. So please come out this Saturday, the 23rd, from 8 to 11, and hope to see you there. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. For my report this week, first I want to announce that our Monrovia Youth Employment Service Program is up and running. We have, I think, 12 interns?
I think so.
12 interns this year. And if you're not familiar with the program, I'm going to give you a real brief synopsis of it. We interview Monrovia students that are in, usually they're sophomores or juniors, and we have them go through an interview, and they work with us throughout the summer here at City Hall, some at the YMCA, but mostly at City Hall in various departments, and they are given real jobs. It's not just fetch me a cup of coffee. This is a real job, and they are also paired up with one of our staff members who will be their mentor through the summer program. Once they've worked through this summer program with us, they will receive a certificate showing that they have been former employees of the City of Monrovia and that they have gone through our process. The best part about this is they start the week with a seminar that talks to them about what does it mean to have a job? How do you do your job? Why is it important to have a job? And then we talk about career advancement and going on to college. So all the while these young people are learning job skills, they're learning life skills. So we're very excited about this year's new crop of interns. You'll see them all around City Hall, all around the city. Congratulate them when you see them because they're all working very hard and this is their first job, most of them. So we're very excited and congratulations to the YES interns on their new positions with us. Last week I attended the U.S. Conference of Mayors. It was a week-long conference in Orlando, Florida, and I wanted to give you a brief recap of some of the things that happened in this very intense conference. First of all, the U.S. Conference of Mayors has a very strong voice when it comes to federal legislation and the federal government. And we go through a process of recommending resolutions to various departments in Washington, D.C. and legislators. So I want to share with you a couple of resolutions that I think are important to us here in Monrovia. The first one is important to everybody. It was a resolution entitled Calling on Congressional Leaders and the President to Work in the Spirit of Compromise to Approve the Comprehensive Balanced Deficit Reduction Plan Immediately. Much of the discussion through this week was centered around the fact that our federal government cannot seem to get its act together and cannot move forward. And so we wanted to make a strong statement to the federal government that we need them to move forward on all of these items that are on their table. The second one that I think is important to our community is a resolution calling for reclassification of medical cannabis to Schedule II of the Controlled Substance Act. And what that really is asking is that the federal government take a look at how they schedule medical cannabis. Right now in the state of California, we have the medical cannabis rules and our law, and it says that the cannabis can be sold out of specific dispensaries. In the city of Monrovia, we have said they can only be located in certain locations. However, this request moves all medical cannabis to Schedule II, and what that means is Schedule II drugs for medical purposes are all sold through pharmacies. And so it was a recommendation of all of the mayors across this country that we have a uniform policy nationally that cannabis for medical purposes are sold at pharmacies. And those are two really important resolutions that I thought you should know about. We had amazing speakers. One of the best parts about being part of this organization is this organization sits down with the directors and the secretaries of different departments, and I want to tell you who spoke to us in this past week, just a few of the people. We had a presentation by Vice President Joe Biden. We were joined in our education committee by Secretary of Education Arne Duncan. We were joined in our women's caucus by Deputy Attorney General James Cole, who gave a very sobering presentation about human trafficking and some of the things that they're doing on the federal level about human trafficking. And I think one of the things that was terrifying and enlightening is he gave us a website that we all immediately went to where you can see if there is such a thing happening in your community, and it is terrifying what's happening in our world, in the world of human trafficking. So there's a lot, there were a lot of suggestions that we can work on with the federal government and with the Attorney General in that regard. We also were joined in the by former Secretary Treasurer Hank Paulson, who gave us a world view of economics based on his knowledge of being the Secretary Treasurer for our country for many, many years. And in our Energy Committee, we were joined by Senior Advisor to the Secretary of Energy, Richard Kaufman, and two of the main topics there were electric vehicles and coal-burning electricity. And next, when we meet again in December or in January, we will be talking primarily about the fracking, the situation with the fracking for expanded oil and gas, mostly gas. So it's very important topics. We also had some presentations about being an election year. They brought people from both sides of the political parties to debate the election issues, and that was fascinating. And some of the people that were there, if you watch TV commentary, you know who Matthew Dowd is. He was there and gave us a very enlightening presentation. We also had a mini debate between Kevin Madden, who works for Governor Romney, and Donna Brazile, who represented President Obama. And that, again, was very fascinating. There were some key moments that in this week. One of them was I've been a member of what are the committees called, the Mayor's Water Council. And for the past 4 years, we've been working specifically with US EPA with regard to water quality issues that relate to municipalities. Some of these issues are stormwater. Other issues are sewers and overflow systems, where you hear that a city's sewer system backs up. That normally is because the sewer lines are 100 plus years old and they're too old to sustain it. And so we've been working with US EPA not to just find the cities for these problems, but to find a plan where we can work together and take the money for the fines and reinvest them into our infrastructure. About 6 months ago, the EPA put out a draft of an integrated water plan, and I invited EPA here to Monrovia, and we invited many of our cities here to meet with EPA and discuss this draft. While we were in the middle of this meeting, actually the day of this committee meeting, EPA sent us the final results of this. So I'm really pleased that we have a final. Is it perfect? No. Is it something we can work with and move forward with? Probably so. So it's a good step forward, and we'll be sharing that with the other cities in our region, because making these issues of stormwater and the extreme costs to our cities to keep the water quality good, the more we can do with EPA in a collaborative way that keeps our costs down and still maintains the water quality is where we need to go. And so I'm really pleased that they're walking side by side with us in this. And then also there was a fascinating discussion about violence in cities and a new company that has taken a whole different perspective on violence within cities. The company is called Ceasefire, and I'll be sharing some of that information with our police department and our city manager and some of the information that I gleaned from that. And this is just a very short list of some of the topics and discussions that were held at this week. It is a very comprehensive conference that starts at 7:30 in the morning, and I don't think we ended before 8 o'clock at night, and then we had a dinner and a dinner speaker every single night. So it's a very comprehensive conference, and I was very proud to represent our city at that conference, and feel like I brought some good information back that we'll be able to share, and some information about some grants and some funds that hopefully can help us fund some of the things we need to do here in our community. The last thing on my agenda is the appointment of our commissions. And every year in the spring, we go through our list of our boards and our commissions, and we see which positions need to be filled. Each of our commissioners have a term of some are 2 years and some are four. It depends upon the commission. And so there's always some turnover, and we go through a process where the city clerk announces the openings. Many of you already know this. We then take applications for the commissions. Interviews are processed, and then at a council meeting, we will make a motion to approve the commissioners that have been recommended by, usually the interviews are held by the chair of the current chair of the commission, the staff member who works with that commission or board, and one of the five of us who is a liaison to one of those commissions. So I wanted to start that and tell you what we're going to do, but I do have a speaker card on this very item, so I think what I'll do is have a speaker speak now before we go through the list. Brian Gerber.
Good evening, Mayor Lutz and City Council members. I stand here in front of you tonight to talk about Old Town Monrovia, the Monrovia Old Town Advisory Board, also known as MOTAB, and to object to the MOTAB board member recommendation that has been made to you. Additionally, I want to ask you to consider changing the selection process so that this becomes a business-voted board, as opposed to a board that is chosen by the mayor and approved by city council members, both who could potentially carry out political agendas or provide favors, rewards, or courtesies to some merchants in town. For example, since the inception of MOTAB, the manager of the Krikorian Theater has always been on the board, and it's been explained to me that this has basically been done as a courtesy to them. Currently, MOTAB serves at the pleasure of the mayor and the city council, when actually it should serve at the pleasure of the Old Town businesses. There was a wonderful brochure published back in 2003 by the Redevelopment Agency titled The Best Time Celebrating the 30th Anniversary of Redevelopment in Monrovia, 1973 to 2003. This publication provides a great recap of the history of redevelopment in Monrovia. Here's a quote from that document which describes Old Town Monrovia in 1995. The downtown was successful, but only just. It was nowhere near the problem area of the 1960s and 70s, but it wasn't a runaway hit either. Since 1992, the innovative Family Night Family Festival, organized and run by volunteer merchants, had been drawing large crowds on Myrtle Avenue one night each week, but hadn't yet translated into success on the other 6 days. Business turnover was still substantial. Vacancies were growing, and office and service businesses were replacing retail. Businesses shut their doors by 7 p.m., and except for one or two restaurants, Myrtle Avenue and its side streets were near empty on weekends. End quote. Sadly, one would think this is describing Old Town Monrovia in 2012, 17 years later. Although we've made many strides, we still fall short of having a thriving Old Town area. One of the resources that we have in Old Town is MOTAB. The purpose of MOTAB is to make recommendations to the City Council on programs and projects to advance the downtown area through marketing, promotion, and overall improvement of the Business Improvement District, and to approve disbursement of MOTAB funds. MOTAB performs the second purpose well, but has fallen short on the first purpose. The time investment of a MOTAB member should go far beyond the 1 hour a month time spent at MOTAB meetings. And even at that, a member is allowed to miss up to 4 meetings in any 12-month period. We need to move forward with a MOTAB that is willing to commit a lot of their time to improve the Old Town area and perform the purpose stated above. We have a lot of changes to make if we are going to have thriving businesses in town. Few businesses in town can truly support themselves solely by their businesses and Old Town. In this time, it is ever so important to have a MOTAB that is proactive and cutting edge. It is time we have retail participation on MOTAB. It is time we get Old Town businesses involved and let them know that they have a voice. I am objecting to the MOTAB board member recommendations for the following reasons. My first reason for objection is that the process for selecting candidates and making recommendations as outlined in Monrovia Municipal Code 2.460402 was not followed. This code section states, quote, the selection committee shall consist of the city council liaison person to the board of the commission, the chairperson of the board or commission, or the vice chairperson if the chairperson is an applicant, and the department director that provides administrative support to the board or commission. Part of the selection process is the interview. Interviews for this board were held on June 6th. I was interviewed by Councilmember Shevlin, City Council liaison person to the board, and Dan Bell, the department director that provides administrative support to the board. Brian Whelan, chairman of MOTAB, was not present. Today I found out that Brian Whelan was present during the other three interviews. This presents a major problem. This gives other candidates a clear advantage and could even imply that a decision had already been made. I do understand Brian Whelan was involved in discussions via telephone with Dan Bell and Becky Shevlin after the interviews to select candidates and make their recommendation. Since he did not participate in the interview process for all candidates, he cannot adequately, fairly, or objectively participate in the selection. Without Brian's adequate, fair, and objective involvement, a recommendation to the mayor and city council that is compliant with Monrovia Municipal Code 2.460402 cannot be made. My second objection is based on the fact that the current Monrovia Old Town Advisory Board is not in compliance with Monrovia Municipal Code Section 5.36120A, which states, quote, the board shall be comprised of five persons who operate bona fide businesses located within the Business Improvement District and that are subject to charges and assessments imposed by this chapter. As a condition of appointment and continued membership on the board, each member shall be current with the payment of charges and assessments imposed by this chapter. At least one member of the board shall represent the retail business component in the Business Improvement District. At least one member of the board shall represent the commercial service professional service business component in the Business Improvement District. And at least one member of the board shall represent a business not located on Myrtle Avenue. The mayor or his or her designee and one city staff member shall act as ex officio non-voting members of the board, end quote. The MOTAB does not currently have retail representation. It has not had for several years, though retail candidates have applied. There are currently four commercial service professional service representations and a property owner on the board. The selection committee's recommendation before you tonight, which reappoints three existing members, does not bring MOTAB into compliance with Monrovia Municipal Code 5.36.120A. The mayor and city council have a legal obligation to ensure that there is compliance. At a time when there are a limited number of retail stores in Old Town Monrovia and sales are weak, it is imperative that there is a retail representation on MOTAB. Mayor Lutz, I am asking that you reject the recommendations made to you by the MOTAB Selection Committee based on the objections I've outlined and instruct the Selection Committee to redo the selection process so that it legally complies with the process outlined in the Municipal Code and that it also make a board member recommendation that places a member on the board that represents the retail business component in the Business Improvement District, which is so critically important. And it would make MOTAB compliant with Monrovia Municipal Code Section 5.36120A. City Council members, in the event Mayor Lutz decides not to comply with the Municipal Code by accepting the Selection Committee's recommendation, I ask that you do not approve it. I also ask that since Councilmember Shevlin was a member of the Selection Committee that made the recommendation that she recuse herself from the vote. I think that is important to point out that Councilmember Shevlin's place of employment is located in the Business Improvement District, which means her employer is subject to the rules of the district, and choice or decisions she makes could provide benefit to her employer, creating a conflict of interest. And following suit, Mayor Lutz's business address is also located in the Business Improvement District, and her business is subject to the rules of the district, and she is making the appointments which can bring benefit to her business. Again, I believe this also creates a conflict of interest. The mayor gets to appoint whoever she wants, and no other business owner gets to do that, which brings me back to my opening statement where I suggested that we let the merchants privately vote for the board. In closing, this is not about my not being recommended for MOTAB. It's about making the process fair and equitable for everyone. It's about following the rules outlined in the municipal code. It's about doing the right thing that will help Old Town Monrovia thrive and prosper. We need retail in this town. A board that is comprised of a gym owner, a property owner, a theater manager, a chiropractor, and a restaurant owner couldn't possibly understand and advocate the needs and requirements of a retail business. I think it's clear that for Old Town Monrovia to thrive, we need to keep current retail businesses and attract new ones. Our residents deserve a thriving, exciting, vibrant, Old Town area that provides them with many opportunities for shopping, dining, and entertainment. And our Old Town merchants deserve a return on their investment. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Mr. Still, there were quite a few comments made related to our municipal codes, and I would like to have you address some of those, if you would.
Yeah, if you could just give me a minute. I'm pulling it up. Questions, as I understand them, were in three sort of categories. One is the process related to the interviews and the attendance of the MOTAB president at the interviews. The second was the representation on MOTAB and the different categories. And the third is, I guess a conflict of interest issue arising because council members have businesses located in the downtown. I'll start with that one last. I don't see any conflict of interest issue related to financial interests of council members. The MOTAB board is not setting assessments or setting charges or imposing taxes or anything like that that could affect the business interests of council members. I understand the argument that I suppose resources could be spent to somehow benefit certain businesses, but that's the system that is set up in the municipal code. It is the system that is called out. And I think that any potential financial benefit is too speculative to create any reasonably foreseeable conflict of interest. With regard to the process, you know, at the end of the day, the and I guess this is the answer to both of the other issues, at the end of the day, the appointments to this board are the mayor's appointment. That's explicit in the municipal code. There is a process for interviewing that is set out in the municipal code, and at times you have to sort of apply a rule of reason to that. Apparently the chair of the MOTAB board was not able to attend all of those interviews. We have had multiple instances in the past where one person or another wasn't able to attend all interview sessions. And I think the mayor just has to judge whether that absence in this particular instance somehow tainted the process such that it should be undertaken again. The issue with regard to representation is really one of interpretation and to some extent semantics. The code doesn't say that the board members have to be certain types of business owners. The code says that they have to represent certain types of businesses. Now, one could say that businesses can only be represented by people who are actually in that business. I suppose that's a perfectly reasonable way to interpret this. Another way to interpret it is you appoint people who know what the interests of those businesses are and are able to represent those interests. again, there's no real definition of what retail is. There's no real definition of what representing the interests of those various categories of businesses mean. And at the end of the day, it comes down again to a question of whether the mayor and the city council believe that the folks that are proposed to be appointed to these, to this commission and to the other commissions, are adequately able to represent the interests that, that are set out in the municipal code. Are they able to present those views and make sure that those views have some place in the decision-making process? And so again, I think it's a matter of interpretation in the appointments process. As far as the idea of directly electing members of the MOTAB board, that would be a very difficult system to implement officially, because really state law doesn't really provide, and state law provides all the election rules, doesn't really provide for the election of representatives to an advisory board like this. You know, you have certain kinds of districts that are set up in state law that where the election, where the representation is determined by election. We would have to set up specifically one of those types of districts in Monrovia to have certain amounts of legal authority in order to create a system where state law would provide for direct election. The only way to sort of bring an election process into this without setting up an actual statutory district is to create some kind of system where we had kind of a poll or an advisory vote, you know, sort of an unofficial campaign among the merchants, and that presents a whole different set of problems and fairness issues that would go along with something like that. So what the city has done is set up a pretty transparent process by which folks are able to apply for these commissions. They're able to express their interest in serving in different ways and go through a process. It may not be what everybody views as being a perfect process at the end of the day, but it's a process that is transparent and that has some structure to it. And at the end of the day, it's intended to provide some advice and some guidance to the mayor and the council as you make these decisions as to who are going to be the folks who represent the various interests on all of the city's commissions.
Thank you. Thank you. I also do want to note that we received a letter from Terry McAuliffe, who had applied for a position in our Historical Preservation Commission, and he states that he did not see the email to him with the interviewing schedule and was not able to attend the interview due to that. So I just want to put that on the record that we had received this letter as well.
Although we did, the city clerk did verify that the email had been sent to him.
Yes, we did double check that it had actually been sent, and to the best of our knowledge, it was received by his server. Correct.
That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
Just for clarification.
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. Could you
go ahead? Joe.
Go ahead.
That is the standard process that the city used for all of the applicants, correct?
Allison's
correct. Right.
So, if I'm not mistaken, there was it 30-something plus?
Well, I can speak to that for the Planning Commission and the Historic Preservation Commission. Each department handles the scheduling of interviews, so I believe Community Services may have used a standard mailed letter for their process, but for all Planning Commission and Historic Preservation Commission, all of those invitations were sent via email, and to my knowledge, that's the only one who did not receive it, or since he did not.
Ms. Shepard.
I just wanted to state for the record that Brian Gerber is not a stranger to Brian Whalen, the chair of the MOTAB board, and that Mr. Gerber had been previously interviewed in a previous round of interviews when we were filling positions. So he had at one time interviewed Mr. Gerber, but yes, he was not able to be present at the current one. Just wanted to make that point.
Okay, so, yes, Mr. Adams.
You know, in all the years I've watched this going on, there's always been complaints and comments about political appointments, and that is what this is to a large degree. But this is the first time I've seen two written complaints about the process, and that adds up to about 10% of our sitting commissioner and board members. And to me, that's a little troubling, and I'm wondering if there might not be some value to take those two appointments and send those back, redo them, bring it forward. Shaking your head no. Why don't you let me finish, then you can
I'm
tell me
no.
I'm
not saying anything.
Send it back and redo those two. We can still move forward with community services and the planning commission and redo those two and hopefully make these two issues go away. And I think to the people sitting at home, it might appear as though we're avoiding even the appearance of impropriety. I'm not saying anyone has done anything wrong, but I think there's always value in avoiding that appearance if we can. And I think there's no urgent matter making these appointments, and it may prove in the long run to be very wise for us to do that.
Any other?
I believe that, like Craig was talking about, was saying that it's up to the mayor to make the appointment. If we need to make some type of, if we need to tweak the process, you know, later, I don't understand if we do it now, and you said from previous times that there was a problem, the people prior to this could say the same thing. So, you know, my thing is I think it should be left up to the mayor, and, you know, if there's something that needs to be done in the future, I believe she knows how to handle it.
Well, if I can at least put in my two cents, since I sat in on the Historic Preservation Commission as a liaison. Again, we had, if I'm not mistaken, seven applicants to this, of which not one but two people were not present at this. And again, basically, unless you have an opportunity to perhaps hear verbal dialogue in the interview process, the only thing you have in front of you to judge by is the application. Mm-hmm. You know, and so that being said, whether or not ultimately a revisit to this would actually change my position on, because there was considerable debate anyway in terms of our appointments, and so whether or not that would change, I don't know. I guess, you know, that would remain to be seen, but I honestly think if we were to move forward, it would only be to redo those, it would only be for the sake of complete transparency. Mm-hmm. You know, and hopefully if we did that, that's not inconveniencing the other applicants. But, you know, again, I mean, they're serving at the pleasure of the council, and so hopefully that wouldn't be an inconvenience. I'm open to discussion about it, you know, I mean, at least in that Historic Preservation Commission, unlike the other commissions, only serves or meets once every, I believe, 3 months. And so there isn't that sense of urgency in the same manner that maybe Planning Commission is. But, you know, again, I'd be happy to...
On MOTAB, there are 3 vacancies and 4 applicants. That's all I can say.
Well, in the past, and my general feeling with these commissions and board appointments is that the interviews are conducted and the recommendations that bring forward, I generally believe we should move forward with the recommendations because of the vetting process that we have, because of the interviewing process. I don't know that bringing these interviews back will change what we have before us today. I don't know if, and I am a little concerned that if we, for example, redo the interviews, what happens if one of the other applicants is not available to redo the interviews? How much weight will we be asking these parties to be giving to the first interview or the second interview, or does one weigh more than the other? I think that we could possibly be creating another situation with it, but where I agree with Mr. Adams is that daylight is always good, and it always will show due process. It will always give the utmost and take away perceptions. So I think that I would like to see MOTAB redo their interviews, and I would like to see Historic Preservation redo their interviews. I truly believe that the process was not tainted, that there was nothing done improper, but in the spirit of daylight, I think that we could go through this process one more time with those 2 commissions. I would recommend that we do that with those 2 commissions. I will ask, however, that process happen as quickly as possible, so at our next council meeting we can move forward, and should one of the candidates, Mr. McCullough, for example, or something again happen, that we not delay it, that we need to make, that we should be making the appointments as soon as possible. So the first meeting in July, if we can move forward with the applicant, with the interviews again, and make those happen.
Well, I agree with the mayor in terms of expediency, and I guess in the spirit of full transparency, what you're offering here, you know, is a chance to rebut the concerns that came from the applicants, and, you know, at least from that standpoint, nobody in the community is going to say that this was basically the fix was in, you know, at least from that standpoint. So, I mean, I would concur with you, Mayor.
Can I clarify, Mayor?
Yes.
Because the process hasn't been concluded, I mean, I think you're suggesting perhaps redoing all of the interviews.
No, I'm only suggesting
just to make sure
the
that,
2 that we have received notifications, objections due. The MOTAB and the Historical Preservation.
But I just want to clarify, within MOTAB,
we
don't need to do all of the candidates, just the individuals that didn't get the full.
Yes, and I'm sorry, I didn't clarify that, because I also am concerned that if we are interviewing the full panel again, we run the risk of somebody not being available.
Able to. So we can
yes,
rely on
I would
the previous
say reach
interviews.
Out to Mr. McCullough, set an interview for him. Set another interview for Mr. Gerber, and move forward and make that expeditious, so that we can finalize these 2 positions by our July 3rd meeting.
Thank you.
And that would be my motion with that regard. So,
I'll second that.
Is there any objections to that?
No, just one other thing, and I think this is a perfect solution to the two complaints. But I do wonder the comment about there being no one on retail from Motab. Is this something we can send back to the merchants and at least get some input from them? I mean, how do they feel about that? Now, Pam, I know you're here, but I think I'd like to hear from the merchants of how they feel about if the rules say there should be someone there from retail and no one's there from retail, are they okay with that? And I don't know that we have that answer, but I do agree 100% with your motion.
I think that we could look at that, although the definition of retail is not in our, as you stated, Mr. Steele, it is not put into our ordinance. And when you look at the pure Webster's definition of retail, it's very broad. And many of the people on our board, you could say, also have retail in there. A restaurant, for example, can fall under a retail definition. So
I could just like to know that the merchants are okay with what we're doing rather than that we're okay with it.
And we can definitely have the merchants look into that, or we can look into that, sure. So if there's no objections, that will be where we'll go with those two positions.
Yeah, I just have a question, Mary.
Okay.
I mean, Mayor, we had three people on the Planning Commission who did not show up. So because they didn't contest it, they can't, you know where I'm going?
I know where you're going. At the risk of opening Pandora's box, I would prefer to keep it to the two that we have specific objections to at this point. I just think we could, you know, somebody could come out and say, well, last year I missed my, you know, I think that could bring us a whole different set of issues.
I think there has been plenty of opportunity for, as we've seen, applicants who felt that the process hadn't treated them correctly. They've come forward and stated that to us. So we have to sort of assume that others who had the same opportunity and didn't complain are probably not in that same boat.
And I'd just like to say that there has been a plea many, many, many times for involvement from the downtown merchants. It's not a secret. Everything from the Vision 2015, or each time we do one of those, or any type of activity, whether it be filming or whatever, to get the merchants involved. And Pam Fitzpatrick, through the co-op, has contact with many of the merchants downtown, almost all of them, and encourages them to be involved as well as I encourage them to be involved. So I understand the concept in this particular instance. I'm not really in agreement, but the concept of I'm just going to leave it at that.
Okay. Then we have some of the other commissions that I would like to move in appointment. For our Planning Commission, and this was a recommendation from Councilmember Larry Spicer, the Planning Commission, Commissioner Carlos, I'm going to say this wrong, Paraga?
Perigee,
I apologize. And Steve Sizemore, the recommendations are to reappoint Bill Beebe and appoint Ann McIntosh and Erica Thomas. And so I would make that in a motion.
Second.
Sorry, could you just clarify that Erica, is this for the unexpired term?
Yes, that's a good point. I thought we would be discussing that part earlier. I'm sorry. Erica will be appointed to replace the remaining term from Commissioner Eric Faith, who has retired. And so that is a term that will end June 30th, 2014. Otherwise, the other two terms are for 3 years. That's my motion.
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye. Aye.
Thank you. This one passes. And then our next commission is the Community Services Commission. Councilmember Shevlin interviewed, along with Phil Lopez from the Community Services Commission. He is the current vice chair. April Soash, the director of Community Services. This recommendation is to reappoint Tom Ditmore and appoint Nancy Matthews to each to a term of 3 years, and I will make that in form of a motion.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. That passes as well. And there were no positions available on the library board this year, so we do not have any recommendations to that board. And our first meeting in July, we will come back with the Historic Preservation Commission and the Old Town Advisory Board. I thank Council very much for this, and I want to thank all of the previous commissioners, and we'll bring you here and thank you for the time that you have spent serving your community so well. And we'll make it an honorable and appropriate thank you to you. And I want to thank all of the people who have taken the time to apply and interview. Unfortunately, we do have limited amounts of positions available, and you know, as you see, there are new people coming on and off of these boards on every year this happens. So if you're interested, please keep applying, because these positions do become available. And that concludes my report this evening. Next, we will go to our administrative reports. Our first administrative report is the adoption of, this is the main event, the adoption of our fiscal 2012-13 budget. And Buffy Bullis will be giving us this report.
Good evening, Mayor Lutz and members of the City Council. This evening, I will be reviewing the proposed fiscal year 2012-13 budget for your consideration. Prior to tonight's presentation, we have had two study sessions to discuss the budget. The first study session was held to review revenue and expenditure projections for all city funds and included a review of proposed fee increases and new fees. And the second study session was held to discuss each department's goals and objectives. Every year, the City Council's priorities are presented to Council for review as part of the budget process. As you will recall, these priorities were presented to Council during the first study session for review. City Council decided not to change the order for the upcoming year. Fiscal responsibility remains the number one priority, followed by public safety. All City Council priorities have been incorporated into this budget. As we discussed at our first study session on May 30th, the economy is continuing to show positive signs of growth and recovery. The budget being presented tonight is structurally balanced. This balance is achieved through modest revenue growth and cost containment, which we will discuss later in this presentation. As you know, effective February 1st of 2012, redevelopment was eliminated. This elimination presented unique challenges to the city in terms of the loss of funding. As a result, modifications have been made to staffing and other expenditures, and these adjustments have been incorporated into the budget. We'll discuss these changes in further detail later in the presentation. And finally, the balanced budget has been developed based on the City Council's priorities, which are the foundation for the development of our budget. This next slide shows the total appropriations for 12-13, which are $59.12 million. This appropriation amount is made up of the following four major fund groups: general operating funds, enterprise funds, special revenue funds, and internal service funds. So next we'll take a look at the general fund. The good news is that consumer spending is making a recovery. Home sale activity has been increasing and sales tax revenue is up. These are a few signs of recovery. While this presents good news for our city, there are still challenges ahead, such as managing and containing future costs. As we look at fiscal year 11-12, we expect overall revenues and expenditures to be on track with the budget. That said, we anticipate a modest surplus of $32,000 at June 30th of 2012. For fiscal year 2012-13, total projected revenues for the general fund equal $31.97 million, and total projected expenditures equal $31.72 million. Based on projections, we expect a budget surplus of $245,000. This helps to reduce our one-time deficit from $650,000 to $405,000 at the end of the fiscal year. So what are the major sources of revenue that make up the general fund's projected revenues of $31.97 million? They are, in order of importance, property tax, sales tax, transfers in, other taxes, charges for services, and other revenues. This next slide shows the breakdown in terms of percentages. As you can see, property tax constitutes 30% of general fund revenues. Sales tax makes up 28%, and the remaining revenues make up 42%. Both property and sales tax are showing signs of growth. Budgeted property tax revenue includes a 4% growth factor, which equates to approximately $361,000. Total budgeted revenue is $9.5 million. Property tax has been historically stable in our city and has not experienced large dips in past years as the economy has plummeted. As for future years, we are expecting growth of approximately 4%. Sales tax revenue is showing signs of steady recovery as well. We are anticipating growth of 5%, which is approximately $413,000. Budgeted revenue is $8.8 million. Our highest year of revenues occurred in fiscal year 2006-07, when we reached $9.4 million in revenues. We are still down $600,000 from that high point. As for future years, we expect continued growth of approximately 3 to 5%. As for other key general fund revenues, one of our largest revenue streams is our hotel occupancy tax. We have seen growth in the last several years, and with all hotels open and up and running, we expect modest growth of 2%. Total budgeted revenue is $1.2 million. As for service and user fee revenues, we expect slow growth as well. This would include such revenues as recreation program fee revenue, building and planning revenues, and other user fees. During our first budget study session, we reviewed our user fees. This year, we are proposing some fee increases and new fees to better align our recovery with the cost of providing services. This will result in some modest increases to revenues, which will help to offset increasing costs for providing those services. In looking at the general fund, we are estimating total general fund projected expenditures of $31.72 million. This is made up of $22.46 million in personnel costs, $7.56 million in maintenance and operations costs, and $1.7 million in transfers to other funds and special project costs. This next slide shows the same breakdown in terms of percentages. As you can see, personnel makes up 71% of the general fund budget, with M&O making up 24%, and transfers and special projects making up 5%. This next slide shows how those expenditures are broken down by category, with public safety being one of the city's top priorities. Our two biggest categories here are police and fire, making up approximately 69% of the general fund budget. We'll now move on to discussing general fund expenditures. As we saw two slides back, personnel costs constitute 71% of the general fund expenditures. With that, we always recognize this is a key area for cost containment. A 2 to 3% average cost increase has been factored into the budget for 12-13 to cover personnel costs such as salaries and benefits, including pension costs. In recent years, we have downsized through attrition and retirement. Over the last few years, over 20 positions have been eliminated from the budget, with approximately 9 of those being in the general fund. We continue to benefit from this downsizing as it has impacted our overall personnel costs. In addition, in 2009, we introduced a two-tier retiree medical program that has helped us to contain retiree medical costs. As we discussed during our first budget study session, one key driver of our city's personnel costs is those costs associated with CalPERS retirement benefits. Based on information received from CalPERS, it is expected that employer rates will continue to increase in the upcoming years. As the city understands the importance of containing this cost component, we are looking at asking employee groups to pick up more of the share of the cost of pensions. In order to meet our long-range financial targets, we are asking that all groups pick up their entire employee contribution by 2013-14. In addition, we are looking at implementing a two-tier pension model for all new employees. This will result in small savings to the city in the short term, with larger, more significant savings being realized in future years. If implemented during fiscal year 12-13, we anticipate that annual savings of approximately $100,000 can be realized in the general fund by fiscal year 2014-15. This next graph, which we saw at our first budget study session, shows PERS employer rates since 03-04. As you can see, the rates are expected to increase over the next several years. The city implemented the principles of public employee compensation last year. These principles tie into two key council priorities, which are fiscal responsibility, priority number one, and maintaining quality city personnel, priority number five. These priorities were incorporated into the creation of the principles. These principles have an impact on our budgeting and negotiation process. Under council priority number one, fiscal responsibility, we have the following principles. Employees shall pay for the employee share of retirement costs. The city PERS program will reflect sustainable horizons. The city total workforce costs must not exceed 75% of net operating expenses. And time accruals will be monitored and utilized to ensure that separating employees' payouts are minimized. Under council priority number five, quality city personnel, we have the following principle. The city shall set compensation competitively based on department mission, program priority, and market forces. Now that we've discussed the current budget, let's take a look at long-term projections. This next slide shows our assumptions that have been included in our five-year forecast. Sales tax at 3-5% growth, property tax at 4%, and other revenues have modest increases. Expenditure assumptions are that personnel costs will increase 2-3% and maintenance and operation costs at 0.5%. The estimates are based on the following assumptions. Fiscal responsibility must remain the top priority. Cost containment is achieved through our compensation policy, and public safety of residents and businesses is top priority. This next graph shows the five-year forecast, and as you can see, revenues and expenditures track closely, with revenues exceeding expenditures in future years. Moving on from the general fund, now we'll take a look at the other city funds. There are approximately 41 other funds covering discretionary and restricted revenue sources. Estimated appropriations total $47.04 million, and estimated revenues total $46.53 million. During our first budget study session, we focused on a few key funds that have important budget considerations during the fiscal year. The funds are as follows: the Housing Development Fund, which is also known as our Community Development Block Grant Fund, the Street Maintenance Fund, the Capital Improvement Fund, and the Storm Drain Maintenance Fund. And I would like to briefly review our discussion of those funds. In the CDBG fund, total appropriations are $303,492. The CDBG program helps to fund code enforcement, residential preservation, and neighborhood recreation programs. There is a 21% reduction in federal funding for the 12-13 fiscal year, which equates to approximately $66,000. Program cuts have been made to accommodate the reduction in funding. Critical programs for safe and healthy neighborhoods will remain, just at reduced levels. Total appropriations for the Street Maintenance Fund total $3.3 million. This appropriation includes funding for street resurfacing projects and operations. The city receives approximately $765,000 in gas tax revenues each year to assist with these projects. The annual street resurfacing program continues to be ongoing. Prop C funding for this program is approximately $500,000 per year. And next is our Capital Improvement Projects Fund. Total appropriations are $2.7 million. Major projects slated include the Transit Village street design improvements. Funding for this project will be provided through federal transportation and MTA funding, and $16.5 million in public improvements from the Gold Line sale. Other projects include Chantry Flats Road Repair, which will be funded through FEMA. The next fund for discussion is the Storm Drain Maintenance Fund. Annual revenues of $280,000 are collected in order to help support cleaning and maintenance of infrastructure. However, additional funds will be needed for infrastructure and replacement. Clean Water Act requirements mandate installation of trash screens in catch basins, which is estimated to cost approximately $850,000 and must be completed by July of 2014. In addition, there will be other costs associated with additional mandates that are expected to cost in the millions over the next 5 to 10 years. Staff is currently evaluating the draft permit that was just released in an effort to determine specific compliance requirements and resource needs. This evaluation of the draft permit and a program budget will be presented later this summer. The new permit is expected to be issued in September of 2012. As you will recall, the redevelopment was eliminated effective February 1st with the passage of AB X-126. With this elimination, the city lost its ability to use redevelopment as a means to assist in developing blighted areas of the city and in assisting with the development in areas that are financially difficult to get a development project started. In addition, the city also lost the ability to keep land proceeds, and issue bonds. Because economic development is an important aspect of our city's overall financial health, we will continue to focus some efforts in this area. Even without redevelopment, the city still has the ability to promote and sell Monrovia to people and businesses. Staff will continue efforts to attract new businesses to our city while reaching out to existing businesses. With the elimination of redevelopment, the city has taken on the role as successor agency. As successor, the city will take on the responsibility of winding down the former affairs of the agency. Regarding funding, the gross loss of funding due to the elimination of redevelopment is $1.5 million. However, since the city will still receive some funding for staffing through direct project cost allocations, and an administrative cost allowance, the net loss is approximately $1 million. With that, we are left with determining how to absorb this loss with the least impact to the services we provide. A total of 7 full-time equivalents, or FTEs, were originally charged to redevelopment. Of these 7, 2 were fully funded through RDA, and all the others were partially funded. 3 will still be funded through redevelopment, 1 through the Housing Authority, and 2 through direct project cost allocation in the administrative cost allowance. In addition, 2 employees moved into existing vacant positions, and as a cost-saving measure, 4 vacant positions were eliminated from the budget. As part of this process, staff evaluated responsibilities in order to best align people with the core services we provide. In addition to modifications to personnel expenditures, other elimination steps include increasing overhead charges to operating departments by 1%, a reduction in phone system and finance system replacement allocations, and deferment of vehicle equipment replacement expenditures. During our first study session, we looked at proposed fee increases and new fees for the 12-13 fiscal year. Each year as we go through the budget process, each department reviews its fees to determine if increases or new fees are needed in order to align fees with the cost of providing each respective service. Fees are then set based on the following considerations: statute, a survey of other agencies charging a similar fee, and a periodic cost study for cost recovery. As we discussed, one of the more critical of these considerations is the latter, ensuring that we have adequate cost to cover the cost of providing service. The next 2 slides show the new fees that are being proposed in each department. First is community services with 4 new fees, which are the IT staff fee, and then under equipment rental, we have canopy, portable stage, and portable sound system. And for public works, we have 1 new fee, which is an annual encroachment permit. And then police has 6 new fees. Under animal control, there's a kennel fee, a dead animal pickup for large dogs, and then 3 vaccination fees, which are 6-1, Bordetella, and FVRCP, and also general municipal ordinance enforcement for penalties. And this next slide is a summary of the departments that have proposed fee increases for the upcoming year. All increases are being proposed to help cover the cost of providing each service. The departments with proposed increases are Community Services, Community Development, Public Works, and the Police Department. In summary, all funds will be balanced for fiscal year 12-13. A balanced budget was achieved by implementing pension cost sharing and a two-tier retirement system for new employees. In addition, no increase in staffing helps to achieve cost containment. Staff will come back to City Council in 6 months for a mid-year budget review to evaluate how revenue and expenditures are tracking. This concludes my presentation. I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have at this time.
Questions of staff.
Bobby, first, thanks for a great review on that. That was very interesting, and I know there's been a lot of meetings leading up to this one. But I just out of curiosity, I know you've got the 71% split right now for salaries. Mm-hmm. And what I'm wondering, like when we cut back on paving streets, and I know we've had to defer some maintenance, and if you go from paving every 5 years to every 6 years, since that's a contract, I would assume that that is not in the 71% salaries because we're paying that out to an outside firm. Is that?
As far as paving, I'm not quite sure if we do all of that, if we outsource all of it, or if we do some of that in-house.
Plus, I think the 71% is a general fund.
Yes, the 71% reflects the general fund only.
Right, and street maintenance is a separate fund that's got a separate revenue source, funding source. So a reduction or even an increase in street services or even salaries is not directly going to reflect
it's 71%. It's a different fund.
Right.
So of the things that you do within the general fund, if it were a like item that gets paid out of the general fund that is a contract item, I'm assuming that would not be reflective in the salaries.
It is not reflected in salaries.
So what I'm curious is that as we've made all these adjustments and changes in tough times, and I know we all have to, if you were to give us a chart of the last 10 years, last 20 years of the comparison of salaries to everything else, how would that look? And I don't expect the answer tonight. But as I look at these numbers, that's the kind of thoughts I come up with. Okay. And perhaps you could work on that before the six-month review.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Kind of give us an idea of what that looks like.
Sure.
And maybe on some of the other funds, too.
Sure. We can do that.
Because, you know, we obviously need to have a balance between paying for good people, but also paying for good materials. Mm-hmm. And you wouldn't want it to be unbalanced in either direction. Mm-hmm. So I just kind of like to take a look at that.
And sure. we'll also look at the professional services to see if that's gone way up, way down.
Well, let's hope not.
Well,
or
I mean, consultant costs.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, that's obviously one way you can drop salaries and benefits like that is you turn around and contract a lot of services and then. Yeah.
Contract out?
Yeah. Well, not necessarily contract out, but if you're going services, if you're not going to hire someone, you can. So that also plays into the bigger picture, too.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, Buffy.
You're welcome.
More questions?
Yes. Go ahead.
You guys are in sync tonight. On the slide, the one about losing the redevelopment monies and funding the 7 employees,
yes.
And it had 3 will continue to be funded, and that's for, as I understand, a brief period or a period of approximately 3 years, correct? And then 2 employees are being reassigned, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And then, so we're trying to fund seven positions, and then the last number was 4 vacant. There are 4 vacant positions that we're not filling, correct?
That we're eliminating, yes.
So the 3, it funded 7, so 3, 2 is 5, and then the remaining 2 equivalent to the 7 are then, they stay where they are, and they're, I'm sorry, I'm trying to make a sense of the math.
No, don't include the 2 in the calculation to get to 7.
Oh,
it's the 7, it's the 3
that
get funded, the 4 that are vacant, 2 are just people moved over from position 1 to position 2.
I gotcha, then. So the 3 and the 4 add
7.
Or 7, and gotcha. Okay.
Any other questions of staff?
Buffy,
yes.
And again, I don't want to put this as any extra burden on staff, but maybe again, as part of the 6-month review, what piqued my interest is our growth, both in our property tax and sales tax. And it's been my, I guess, my experience in remembering previous budgets over the years, it seemed like even in surplus years, our growth didn't really deviate that much from our current numbers that you're projecting here. It seemed to be on an average 4% growth. I'm trying to remember if you could look at trending that over the last, you know, 10 years,
yeah,
and that way we have an idea
10, 15, 20
then,
years.
You know, I mean, are we, you know, do we continue to grow? Is it reflected in terms of that?
In our better years from the sales tax, we've been 5 to even 7%. Lower years have been, you know, 1 to 2%. Obviously, we're just coming out of the doldrums of going down.
Right.
Property tax has been more steady because we're a built-out community where we're not going to have the fluctuations of big new housing developments and then things going upside down. So our fluctuation in property tax is a little bit more stable, right around the 3 to 5 is pretty much where we've been, except obviously the last couple of years have been a little bit lower. But we can go back and come back with a history of the last 15,
okay,
20 years of that.
And also, you mentioned, I believe it was about a 2% escalator that you put in for salaries. In terms of that, now is that you padded that budget? Is that based on cost of living, or I don't?
We don't use the word padded. Padded was never used in the presentation.
Sorry to put you on the
padded in the slush fund.
that was overall personnel cost increase. It wasn't an increase to salaries. It was, we look at the overall personnel costs, because there could be cost salary increases and personnel costs, and obviously our pension increases is built into that.
And so you used our current contracts as the basis,
yes,
for that, correct?
Right. Yes.
Plus our assumptions of what we're trying to get to in terms of pension cost sharing and all that.
I'm sure it's just semantics, I know.
Yeah, the ECB, the extra cash flow.
Okay, any other questions of staff? Buffy, great presentation, as we have been having all along with the budget discussions. We really appreciate the thoroughness that you've been presenting to us. And for those at home who maybe did not see our previous two study sessions regarding the budget, we looked at the hard numbers. We looked at particularly we had a lot of discussion about the changes in some of our fees and how that works and how it relates and why we were making some of those changes. And overall, I want our residents to know that the recommendation to make some of the changes in our fees are to recoup our costs. That's solely what it is. And in the most cases, it doesn't even recoup 100% of our costs. Probably our average is between 70 to 80% of our costs average out. Mm-hmm. Of what we recoup from the fees, so we're always kind of playing catch up with those. Mm-hmm. But I appreciate that this is a tough budget, and it's a budget that, while we're balanced, it's not without pain. Mm-hmm. We're fortunate in that this budget does not have us laying off employees, but by the same token, we've eliminated 4 positions. We just happen to not have anybody sitting in those jobs at this moment. Had we had people sitting in those jobs, we would have had a much tougher decision. So we're still cutting our staff overall. We're just fortunate that nobody is leaving us, that we didn't have to have actual layoffs.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But this is a tough budget in that we are still taking a hit. We are still having to tighten our belts, and this will probably continue for a while as we start to recover back up from where we were. Unfortunately, the measures and the things that we've been doing for the last 5 years to get back to where we need to be. Is, you know, Mr. Adams talked about that we push deferred maintenance, we push things back to catch up on those things that our city needs to do is going to cost us more money when we need to get to them because they've been deferred. And so it's still going to take us time to get back where we need to be, but I appreciate the work that you did on this budget.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions or comments? Okay, we will entertain a motion.
I'll move adoption.
Second.
Any further discussion? May we have a roll call vote, please?
Councilmembers Adams?
Yes.
Shefflin?
Yes.
Spicer?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Garcia?
Yes.
And Mayor Lutz?
Yes. Thank you very much. Thank you, Buffy. Our next item is Administrative Report 2, which is the repeal of a prohibition for solicitation in the public right-of-way, and our city attorney, Craig Steele, will give us this report.
Thank you, Mayor, members of the City Council. The City of Monrovia, like many other California cities, has a section of the Municipal Code which, on the one hand, prohibits persons from standing in the public right-of-way and soliciting employment, business, or monetary contributions from cars and drivers that are traveling in the right-of-way. And on the other hand, prohibits persons who are in the cars traveling on the right-of-way from soliciting employment or business from people or patronizing people standing in the right-of-way. Many cities adopted this type of ordinance in the early 90s to address problems such as day laborers soliciting employment outside of home improvement centers and other similar types of businesses, persons selling fruit and other things on street corners and causing significant public safety problems and traffic problems in the right-of-way. Early in the 90s, the California Court of Appeal, in a reported decision, found that this type of ordinance was legally valid and necessary to protect public safety and vehicular traffic. And so cities adopted this type of ordinance and have been enforcing it for many years. Various interest groups, after losing the California Court of Appeal case, continued to pursue the invalidation of this type of ordinance through the federal courts. A few years ago, a federal district court in Los Angeles struck down one such ordinance, and that involving the county of Los Angeles, and that case was not appealed. And more recently, the federal district court struck down an ordinance like ours in the city of Redondo Beach. That case was appealed. First, a panel of the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals reversed the trial court and held that the ordinance was valid. And then, in a relatively unusual occurrence, the full panel of judges on the Ninth Circuit held what's called an en banc review of the case and reversed their colleagues and held that this type of ordinance violates the First Amendment to the Constitution because it basically over-regulates First Amendment protected activity, soliciting employment or making sales, that kind of thing. It basically regulates too much speech or more speech than is necessary to create the safe public right-of-way that municipalities are trying to protect. And so, based on that Ninth Circuit decision, many, which is of course binding in California and on Monrovia, many municipal ordinances are virtually identical to the one that was struck down in Redondo Beach, as is Monrovia's. And so cities have been repealing that section of their municipal code in response to the Ninth Circuit case in order to comply with that decision. And we recommend that the City Council repeal its ordinance as well to comply with that Ninth Circuit decision. We have provided the ordinance to you that would only repeal those specific sections that were found to be objectionable in the Redondo Beach case or those that were similar to what was struck down in the Redondo Beach case, trying to make the impact of this as narrow as possible. But we do recommend that the council introduce and waive further reading, read by title only, the ordinance before you that would repeal that one section of the Monrovia Municipal Code with regard to solicitation in the public right-of-way. That concludes the staff report, and be happy to answer any questions.
Questions of staff.
So all of our publicly owned parking lots are part of the public right-of-way, I take it. The downtown parking lots?
I'm not willing to go that far with it yet. It's clear that the private parking lots are not obviously part of the public right-of-way. Right now, we're not extending the decision to apply to public property in general. It's really related to the specific issue in the ordinance, which is public right-of-way.
But this says commercial parking lots.
That's the title. That's the title of the chapter that this section appears in. It's not that whole chapter is not being repealed. It's only one section of the chapter is being repealed. So the section relating to commercial parking lots, which prohibits allows property owners to regulate this in their own commercial parking lots, that's still going to be in effect.
Okay, but for all the publicly owned lots downtown, are they treated the same as the right-of-way?
We're not repealing anything related to public parking.
So this is just...
This is only the
street.
What's designated on city maps as public right-of-way.
Probably including the sidewalk, everything?
Yes, in most cases.
So people can stroll up and down Myrtle Avenue soliciting business?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions?
That was really my question.
Okay. I have a question. Which may or may not relates to it, and it has to do with the advertising of businesses on our sidewalks and things. I believe that there's a rule, and I don't know if it'll apply to this, that it cannot be static if you're standing there with a sign for your business. It has to be a live, moving something or other. Is that going to be affected by this at all?
No, those provisions of the sign ordinance are not are still going to be in effect.
Still in effect. So when Mr. Adams says somebody can stroll up and down our sidewalks doing business or advertising their business, they literally have to stroll. They have to be moving.
Yes.
Okay.
If we're talking about with an advertisement
with
or a sign.
An A sandwich
sign
or an A sign.
Handing out flyers.
Right.
Can I expand on that a little bit then, just as a hypothetical? So if somebody happens to be strolling on the sidewalk, perhaps with a bullhorn, advocating whatever it is, that is now permissible?
That's always been permissible.
That's truly freedom of speech.
Yeah.
Yes. That's all. We're kind of into different impacts, but other than our residential picketing ordinance, which regulates that type of activity in residential areas, speech on a street corner with a bullhorn or walking up and down the sidewalk has always generally been protected speech on public property.
But so now the people that are running the computer show in Pasadena could have people cruising up and down Myrtle Avenue trying to get people to attend the computer show in Pasadena.
Yes, as long as they're not impeding traffic on the sidewalk, stopping, setting up a table or something like that.
All right.
That would be a problem.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. We do, unless there are other questions, we do need a motion.
I'll move we introduce, waive further reading and read by title only, ordinance number 2012-05.
I'll second.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. This passes.
Mayor,
and now we
should
please read.
Title.
Yes.
It's ordinance number 2012-05, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Monrovia, California, repealing section 8.34.020, prohibition of solicitation in a public right-of-way, of Chapter 8.34, solicitations of employment, business, or contributions within the public right-of-way and within commercial parking lots, of Title VIII, Health and Safety of the Monrovia Municipal Code.
Thank you. We pulled our consent calendar item number 6, and so we will now take up the consent calendar item number 6 for what I hope will be a brief report from Ron Poe. But informative, very informative.
It'll be brief, and I'll try to frame it as briefly also. The report that you have before you, CC6, is an opportunity for the city to purchase some water, whether it's replacement water or it's cyclic storage water. At this point in time, our forecast is that there's a good chance that we will be able to produce water because of the low demand and our conservation efforts since 2005, that we'll be able to use this water and actually move it forward to the next pumping year, which is 12-13, and save this cost. We're actually saved quite a bit because, as you know by the report, the increased cost of buying replacement water is starting to increase. We're buying it at a lower rate of 90% below the water master rate, which is 640, and next year it's going to be 690. The cost of buying water is definitely on the rise. With our conservation efforts, we've definitely been able to reduce our production by over 1,000 acre feet over the past 6 years. By saving that money, we've been able to bank it for those dry years. By doing that, we also budget replacement costs just in case that we overproduce and that we have to buy replacement water. In a nutshell, how it works is the safe yield is set by Water Master every year, and the safe year just goes alongside with the weather. If we had a good rain year, like back in 2004-05, we had about 45 inches of rain. We actually found out that the basin started recovering really fast, and we had a high yield. The yield was so high at 248,000 acre feet. Our percentage, which is 3% of that 240 acre feet, really provided us so much water that we were able to not only produce within our means, but be able to save that water and carry it over to the following year. So while that's the advantage of having a high yield, the disadvantage of having a low yield in droughts is that we have a lower percentage. So all the conservation efforts that we have, it's still probably will not meet our demands because the low yield at 170 an acre, 170,000 acre feet, the percentage, you can calculate that out, is pretty low. We average right around 6,800 acre feet a year. Calculation, I think, is about 5,000 acre feet. So we have to pay a replacement cost to refurbish the groundwater basin. We call it replacement costs. It's a replenishment cost. It's a replenishment to the basin. Think of it as like a checking account. You can only draw out so much, and then you get into, you know, to the point of like, well, I need to, put more money back in the bank so that way I can spend it. It's the same thing with the groundwater basin. Our sweet spot is 200,000 acre feet to 240,000 acre feet. If we're right in that sweet spot, replacement cost is not something that we have to pay. Below that, then we start having to pay a replacement cost. I'll answer any other questions that you'd like to ask.
So is the amount that we're paying now, is it replacement cost for already over pumping, or is it in anticipation?
By our projections, mm-hmm. It's kind of like a safety net. Our projections, we're anticipating that we will not have to pay a replacement cost this year. So this water that we're buying, we could actually bank it. And should we have to pay a replacement cost next year, we could go into the bank and use that. We could also carry it over. We can carry over 3 years of any maybe underproduction for 3 years. And after that, we have the advantage of actually putting it into a cyclic storage account is what we call it. Right now, we, over the years, in those good years where we've underproduced, we've been able to carry over and then actually put it into a cyclic storage account, and we have about 800 acre feet right now.
And that word you use, produced, it's actually, that's pumping, correct?
Yes. It's pumping out of the groundwater.
Okay.
Groundwater basin, which is the main San Gabriel basin.
Say, Ron,
yes.
I, I know last year they were draining, was it Morris Reservoir, I think? So they could go and clean everything up behind Morris Dam?
Yes.
And it looked like that was actually raising the groundwater because they ran it all down through the percolation pits.
That's exactly the intent of what they were trying to do. I think Morris Dam hasn't been cleaned for, I'm probably up to maybe 15 years, maybe. Because of the various droughts and try to store water behind the dam, timing wasn't always good to clean the dam, but it was a point in time where the percolation wasn't getting down to the groundwater basin, and they needed to do it right away. And that's
what. But that did help.
Well, it helped quite a bit.
So, how much are we paying? Is it Montebello we're buying this from?
Alhambra.
Yes.
And how much are we paying them per acre foot?
576.
And on an average, what do you sell that for?
I think I don't know by the acre feet. It actually costs us to pump it out of the ground about $230 an acre foot.
$230 on top of what you're paying Alhambra.
Yeah. We have to pump it out of the ground for $230. We buy it for $576, and we pump it out of the ground for about $230.
I'm not sure I understand that. Wait. So the $230 is what the water that's allocated to us costs to get out of the ground?
It's what it costs for energy consumption,
right?
And what we have to pay over the years if we pay an assessment cost.
Okay.
And the assessment cost is an administrative cost for Water Master to be the governing body for the basin,
right?
To either look and forecast MWD water that they may be able to sell to us for replenishment, or various other means, whether state water project or Colorado water project.
Mm-hmm.
So what they do is that's how they figure out what the cost is going to be, and we have to pay the cost for replacement. The replacement cost changes from year to year, depending on the availability. For instance, I kind of ran some numbers. Over the past years, it cost $512, for replacement cost. That was 10-11, and prior to that, it was $587.
And that's for the overage?
Yes, for the overage.
Okay. So did you say $230?
$230 is what it costs us.
And that's what it costs to get our water?
That's to get our water with energy costs and everything within our rights. So take that percentage, whatever it is for the yield.
Right.
Let's just say for talking purposes, our percentage and our allocations, our water rights is mm-hmm. 5,000 acre feet. So 5,000 acre feet, it costs us about $230 an acre feet to pump it out.
And then what does it cost if we're going to pay Alhambra $580? What does it cost to get Alhambra's water out of the ground?
Their cost, they can't. The reason why they're selling their rights is because they have wells that they cannot utilize.
Okay.
So their groundwater basically, they can't touch certain areas of the groundwater.
Okay.
But they belong to another water basin. So if they can get other water rights from the other basin, they offset it by selling the costs.
Right.
So that's one of the reasons why they can sell it for whatever this cost is. This is actually the last year that we're able to buy it at a lower rate than Water Master. Starting next year, Water Master is going to be the sole proprietor to purchase water, and then we'll have to pay whatever the replacement cost is through Water Master.
But the $580 is not a delivered cost, is it?
The $580 is just the total cost to get the water from their water rights, I guess would say.
But then we still have to pump it up.
Correct.
And what does that cost to get Alhambra's water into our reservoir? Because you've got pumps and electricity and
actually all it is for us, we're still pumping out of the same groundwater basin, but it's just a paper trail of taking the allocation that they have and putting it towards Monrovia, and then we pump it out of the ground for that $230 cost.
I might be missing something here. If you never use their water,
yes,
your electric bill would be a lot lower.
Yes, but we would still have to pay a replacement cost to.
No, I mean if you never used any of that
mm-hmm.
water. If we only used the water that's allocated to us,
mm-hmm.
we would have a certain amount of cost associated with bringing our allocation up to use.
Correct.
Now we're going to use more, and whether it's Alhambra's water or paying for the overage, there has to be cost associated with getting that water out of the ground in addition to what we pay Alhambra. Is that $100? Is it?
I'm sorry. Maybe the way I framed it isn't probably painting the picture correctly. This water that we're purchasing, we can use it for whatever it may be, because even if we were not to buy this water and we were to just pump regularly right now, if we overpump, we'd still have to buy some water somewhere for the overpumping the water. Now, whether it's from Alhambra or whether it's from Watermaster, which we know the Watermaster cost is $640 right now, we're still getting it at a bargain rate. It's a cost of having water available to us, whether we're overpumping it or pumping it within our rights. It's still a process that we're going to have to follow, because the water's not there. We're pumping more than we need to if we have to overpump.
I guess, Ron, another way to ask is, we are paying $578 plus $230 on the water, or is it $578 plus an additional amount for the energy cost of pumping?
We pay $230 right now for our percentage of the yield. That's our cost.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Our 230 plus whatever administrative cost we have to pay Watermaster.
I understand that.
Yeah.
And then this 580 goes to Alhambra.
Yeah. And anything above that, we would pay our replacement cost. So what we're asking council tonight is, this water that we're paying, no matter how you look at it, whether it's going to be replacement costs now for this year or for next year, it's still cheaper than what we're going to have to pay for replacement costs, because the yield for next year, you know, it changes. It's not a set yield that every year we have the same thing. So our percentage could be lower, where we may have less water to be able to pump against our percentage. So right now, you know, we may pump, I think it's 6,800 acre feet. Next year, we may pump more than that, and our allocations are shy of that. So what this will do will help us make up the difference. That's all we're asking.
And I understand all of that, and I appreciate it, but what does it cost to get the water out of the ground?
The cost to get it out of the ground, we've estimated to be $230 an acre foot.
Okay, so the 580 to Alhambra, and then 230 on top of that, puts the landed cost in your reservoir.
You're correct. You're correct.
Or something.
You're correct.
Okay.
You're correct.
All right. Thank you.
My apologies.
No problem.
Past my bedtime.
Sorry. Any other questions? No. Ron, I appreciate you giving this report to us. I know I was unclear as to what we were doing with the water, and I wasn't sure if we had actually overpumped, but your explanation clarifies that for me. I appreciate that very much.
Thank you.
We're looking for a motion.
Move approval.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Motion carries.
Thank you, Ron.
This concludes our meeting tonight. This meeting was a very important meeting because of the budget issue that we approved. This happens, you know, twice a year we go through and we evaluate our budget. And as I said earlier, this was an important budget, and it was a tough budget because of what we're going to be doing. And one thing I was remiss in talking about, and I want to make sure that I make this very clear. If it were not for the phenomenal staff that we have at this City Hall doing more with less every single time we do a budget, we could not make the services in this city to the level that our customers, of residents, require. Our city staff is to be commended for the work that they're doing, even in light of budget cuts, staff reductions, all kinds of supplies being cut, and major pressure to do more with less. So We want to thank you for the work that you're doing for this community. And I know that every resident in our city thanks you for the work that we're doing, and we will move on, and hopefully our budget dollars will get larger, and we will be able to relieve some of this pressure soon. But thank you very much, and with that, we are adjourned.